Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Holy Trinity by the Lake and to our 10:30 service of Holy Eucharist. Before we open our prayer books today, I want to name that our hearts are collectively heavy this week. We grieve the shooting, especially of children less than 400 miles from here in a school in Texas, our own state. Utterly disoriented, we search for our bearings and for next right steps. And at the heart of our steps, whatever they will be, as in the center of our common life, we pray. So I offer this prayer at the very beginning so that the rest of our words this morning can be true. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, whose only Son came to preach peace to the nations, hear us, we beseech you, and comfort us with your steady hand. As we come before you this day in the wake of unspeakable violence, the most recent shooting of children at Robb Elementary School in Uvalde, Texas, the attack of Taiwanese churchgoers at Geneva Presbyterian Church in Orange County, California, the racially motivated shooting of shoppers at a Buffalo, New York grocery store. In a world that sometimes seems hopeless, help us to remember that our hope rests always in you, and in the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Renew in us a sense for the common good and the flourishing of every human being, and lead us to actions that cause our lives to rhyme with our prayers. We pray this through our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Just now, I want to share a short song that our family uses. We get it from the community of Tizé. It's a song that we have learned to sing in times where we hold our hope and our grief in the same space together. I want to invite Marla and Riley to come. The choir is going to help us sing it. These are the words. Within our darkest night, and this should be the, you kindle the fire. You kindle the fire that never dies away. And that's it. That's the song. Within our darkest night, you kindle the fire that never dies away. And right now, Lauren and our choir are going to lead us in singing it a few times through. And I invite you just to join as you feel led and as it becomes familiar to you.
Thank you.
We continue our prayers on page 355. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the King of glory, you have exalted your only Son, Jesus Christ, with great triumph to your kingdom in heaven. Do not leave us comfortless, but send us your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and exalt us to that place where our Savior Christ has gone before, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God in glory everlasting. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of Scripture.
Paul and Silas are unjustly jailed for setting a young girl free from a demon. When all the prisoners are miraculously freed, the jailer recognizes Jesus Christ as Lord. A reading from the book of Acts. With Paul and Silas, we came to Philippi in Macedonia, a Roman colony, and as we were going to the place of prayer, we were met by a slave girl who had a spirit of divination and brought her owners much gain by soothsaying. She followed Paul and us, crying, "These men are servants of the Most High God who proclaim to you the way of salvation." And this she did for many days. But Paul was annoyed and turned and said to the spirit, "I charge you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her." And it came out that very hour. But when her owners saw that their hope of gain was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the rulers. And when they had brought them to the magistrates, they said, "These men are Jews, and they are disturbing our city. They advocate customs which is not lawful for us Romans to accept or practice." The crowd joined in attacking them, and the magistrates tore the garments off of them and gave orders to beat them with rods. And when they had inflicted many blows upon them, they threw them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely. Having received this charge, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in stocks. But about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's fetters were unfastened. When the jailer woke and saw that the prison doors were open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul cried with a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." And he called for the lights and rushed in, and trembling with fear, he fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, "Men, what must I do to be saved?" And they said, "Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household." And they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all that were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their wounds, and he was baptized at once with all his family. Then he brought them up into his house and set food before them, and he rejoiced with all his household that he had believed in God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The portion of the Psalter appointed for today is Psalm 97, found in your service leaflet. Please read with me in unison. The Lord is King. Let the earth rejoice. Let the multitude of the isles be glad. Clouds and darkness are round about him. Righteousness and justice are the foundations of his throne. A fire goes before him and burns up his enemies on every side. His lightnings light up the world. The earth sees it and is afraid. The mountains melt like wax at the presence of the Lord, at the presence of the Lord of the whole earth. The heavens declare his righteousness, and all the people see his glory. Confounded be all who worship carved images and delight in false idols. Bow down before him, all you gods. Zion hears and is glad, and the cities of Judah rejoice because of your judgments, O Lord. For you are the Lord of the earth. You are exalted far above all gods. The Lord loves all people. He runs with the saints and delivers them from the hand of the wicked. Light has sprung up for the righteous, and joyful gladness for those who are true-hearted. Rejoice in the Lord, the righteous, and give thanks to his holy name.
John's vision closes with words from Jesus warning against ignoring or denying the truth presented here and exhorting the spread of the good news about God's coming kingdom. A reading from the Revelation to John. "See, I am coming soon. My reward is with me to repay according to everyone's work. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they will have the right to the tree of life and may enter the city by the gates. It is I, Jesus, who sent my angel to you with this testimony for the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright morning star. The Spirit and the bride say, 'Come,' and let everyone who hears say, 'Come,' and let everyone who is thirsty come. Let anyone who wishes take the water of life as a gift. The one who testifies to these things says, 'Surely I am coming soon.' Amen. Come, Lord Jesus." The word of the Lord.
At this time, I'd like to invite any children who would like to come to the Children's Chapel today to come to the front of the church for a special blessing. Hey there, Jameson. How are you, sir? Good. Ready for summer, absolutely. Ellie, I love your shoes. Fashion forward. All right, so our blessing is the same one it's been this whole season of Easter, and this is the last day of our Easter season before next week, which is Pentecost. So just as a little refresher for all of us, Christ before me, Christ behind me, Christ above me, Christ below me. Then you get choices. You can do Christ around me or Christ around me if you're in the pew, and Christ within me. You ready? Let's pray. Christ before me, Christ behind me, Christ above me, Christ below me, Christ around me, Christ within me. Amen. Bless y'all and have a wonderful few minutes. We'll see you in just a little bit. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus prayed for his disciples, and then he said, I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, as you, Father, are in me, and I am in you, may they also be in us. So that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, that they may become completely one, so that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them, even as you have loved me. Father, I desire that those also whom you have given me may be with me where I am, to see my glory, which you have given me before you loved me, before the foundation, because you loved me, before the foundation of the world. Righteous Father, the world does not know you, but I know you, and these know that you have sent me. I made your name known to them, and I will make it known, so that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Thank you.
In the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. The book of Acts, from which we get to read a lot of extra stories and a lot of extra readings in this season of Easter, it's one of the trappings of Easter, the wonderful trappings of Easter, along with the candle and the white and all the rest. We read more from the book of Acts. The book of Acts tells the story of the early church, but not just the early church, the earliest church, like the baby newborn while the face is still scrunchy before it is cute church. And it's good for you and I to remember sometimes, maybe, on those days where we might feel something like a younger sibling church, clumsily trying to live up to the fabled golden age, the fabled perfection of the flawless older child, the early church. It's good for you and I to remember that less than two chapters into the book of Acts, things are a total mess, like wildly out of hand. It takes less than two chapters for Peter, the rock, the foundation, to find it necessary to preach the disclaimer, no, we're not drunk. Pete, what the heck? He gives you the keys for all of 5 minutes, and now we need a breathalyzer benediction? First, they lose Jesus. It's true. Ever since, people have been going around places like Texas and all the rest, asking one another, have you found Jesus? Because they lost him. No, well, so Jesus has disappeared in a cloud. He's ascended. Next thing you know, the disciples, once locked up for fear, are out of the cage, on the loose, like Jurassic Park when the cables go down. Hold on to your butts. Sacred Samuel L. Jackson translation. Something like fire appears to break out. Fire and chaos, and this is important, just like the shrub that Moses found that day when he was minding his own sheep on the hillside, way back at the very beginning of the story, the shrub that burned and burned but didn't burn up, the fire that falls on Jesus' friends and turns the world all upside down, it's kind of like that. It destroys nothing, opens everything. Like how some seeds stay dormant in the soil until the heat of the wildfire signals new life and somehow the seed discerns a new possibility, knows that this is the moment for opening, this is the moment to grow. The fire destroys nothing, opens everything at the just right time. Most of all, their hearts. And all of a sudden, people are reaching out to people they didn't used to reach out to, across ethnic lines, across lines of difference and indifference, across lines of reluctance, status, and success, across lines of calcified grudges. Evidently, this fire fans forgiveness, and fears are slowly disappearing. No one has categories yet for just what they're seeing, what they're living. But as they reach out to each other, as they reach out to one another, they're discovering their own selves too. True selves uncovered as they locate themselves in the community and communion of God's beloved and holy people. So Peter stands up and he offers that great first line to his sermon with a shrug. Real talk, y'all. I didn't see it coming either, but here we are. Don't know what to tell you, except we're not drunk. Fire is falling. And despite what certain billboards will tell you, be happy to tell you in Texas and other parts across the South, Scripture's central understanding of fire is not fire and brimstone. It's the fire of the presence of God. The fire of the presence of God that dwells in the holy temple. And in the book of Acts, Luke is helping us see that Jesus, in Jesus, the temple that holds the fire has been transformed. The fire, once locked away in the innermost parts of the temple, it's out, and it's landed on human heads, no longer hidden behind ginormous stones, but in the beating heart of God's people. The fire dwells in them, and this fire is turning heads. Sometimes it looks a little crazy, The world is not the same, it seems, for the ones who preach this Jesus. So no, they're not tipsy, but the world is now topsy-turvy. So when we come along to the 16th chapter of Acts today, it's good for us to remember that it's still the same fire that we're watching. At this point in Luke's story, we've fully entered the Spirit's upside-down world, an upside-down world where singing hymns can bring down prison walls. Crazy. And crazier, the prisoners don't run away, because in this upside-down world, they aren't the ones who are fearful. But in the upside-down world, it's the soldier, it's the guard who comes to the captives to ask for freedom. "What must I do to be saved?" he says. And their answer is Jesus. But don't forget that his question isn't just Sunday school curiosity. It's life and death for him. Because assuming the newly freed convicts don't kill him, which he may well expect, the system that put him in his little corner of power, that prison ostensibly over the prisoners, that system, once they find out that the prisoners have escaped, almost certainly will. He's failed to keep the captives captive, but these captives are not captive, even in their captivity. Paul and company, imitating their Savior, do not count the presence of God as something to be exploited. They don't use the moment to their own advantage. They don't escape. But the walls come down, and the next thing they do is they open their hearts to the jailer. They share Jesus with him, and he in turn opens his own home to them, together becoming new creation. Crazy. It's cliche to say they have hearts on fire, but that's exactly what it is. And their single-mindedness, their burning love for God and neighbor, occasions a healing that is at once personal and of public consequence. The fabric and logic of oppression has begun to unravel on itself. Just like in the other healing in our reading today, the exorcism that led to their imprisonment in the first place, we heard that Paul and the company had healed a young woman. The healing exposed an exploitative economic arrangement that was built on her captivity. Folks were making money off her enslavement. It is a lot like the time Jesus sent some demons into a herd of pigs. You remember that story? And the next thing you know, the pigs run off a cliff. And folks get mad. They get mad because good bacon was lost. They aren't mad or afraid about a possessed man kept in chains haunting people in the tombs. After all, who gave him his chains but them? They're mad and afraid about a world in which the man is set free, where the status quo that has some people making a living off of the dying of others is shown for what it is and turned upside down on its head. Crazy. In his book, Crazy Christians, Presiding Bishop Michael Curry observes that the ones who follow Jesus, now as then, may turn the world upside down, but the craziness of the Spirit who animates us isn't magical or heroically unattainable, what my dad would call the big S saints. In some ways, Curry says, it's simple. Says Curry, following Jesus sometimes means caring more when we are tempted to care less. Sometimes, he says, sometimes following Jesus means standing up when others are sitting down. Sometimes following Jesus means speaking up when others are shutting up. Sometimes following Jesus means being different, he says, which is just to say being who you already are in Christ, in public. Do you hear that? Sometimes the upside-down world of Jesus is as near as showing up where others won't, risking greater nearness to the griefs and groanings of this world. Like St. Jude Hospitals for Children. St. Jude, of course, the patron saint of lost causes. Can you imagine having your child conceived of as a lost cause? But for generations, Christians have shown up alongside these kids in these places and proclaimed exactly there and worked toward the healing and the hope of the risen Christ in them and for them. Because sometimes the upside-down world of Jesus is simply showing up where others give up, which is to say, presence. Presence. Like Trevor Huddleston, a British pastor sent to Africa, who met a young boy who became a faithful acolyte in his church. Curry tells the story. At one point, the boy became ill and had to be hospitalized. Unfortunately, because of poverty and politics and other reasons, the hospital was a very great distance away. But during the child's illness, the priest visited him regularly and told him stories from the Bible, stories of Moses and Miriam, stories of the Exodus, of David and Goliath, stories of Mary and her baby. Eventually, the boy recovered and came home. The church reassigned the priest, but he and the boy stayed in touch. The boy later went on to become ordained. The young boy's name was Desmond Tutu. Looking back, Bishop Curry wonders out loud what all that was really about. Was that experience about evangelism or social action, he asks? Was it liberal or conservative? Was it high church or was it low church? Was it pastoral or prophetic? It doesn't matter, he says. Trevor Huddleston and Desmond Tutu were simply following Jesus, showing up where others wouldn't, in this case, to one another, trusting the Spirit to handle the rest. Made present by the power of the Holy Spirit. Those words sound a lot like how God came to us, was made known to us the first time in Jesus, Christmas and the Incarnation, made present by the power of the Holy Spirit. It's also how we say Christ shows up still in the breaking of bread at this holy table, made present by the power of the Holy Spirit. And it's also how we understand our call, our invitation, out, up, and into a world that includes even unspeakable heartaches like Uvalde, like Ukraine, like Buffalo, like Orange County. Acts tells the story of God's people, God's church, made present by the power of the Holy Spirit. Acts tells the story of the Spirit subsequently turning the world upside down until we realize that what we once thought was the ceiling is really the floor and vice versa. You might say Acts recalibrates our imaginations and our hearts. Acts is new fire, which destroys nothing, opens everything, opens our hearts to one another and the whole weary world. Moment by moment by moment by moment. And Acts is God's invitation to us to be present. As present as the God who in Christ shows up where, if left to our own devices, we might otherwise give up, whose word breaks every silence of our despair, who in Jesus Christ, yesterday, today, and forever, is making all things new. Every last and thought to be God-forsaken thing, new, whole, holy. This one may we follow. Let us pray. This prayer comes from the great vigil of Easter at the heart of our Christian life together. O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were being cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please stand as you are able, and let us reaffirm our faith in the living God by the words of the Nicene Creed found on page 358. We believe in one God, the Church of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people are Form 3, found in the Book of Common Prayer, page 387. Father, we pray for your Holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
On this Memorial Day weekend, we pray, merciful and almighty God, whose Son came among us and laid down his life for us, showing us the fullness of your love for all people, we remember with prayerful and thankful hearts before you this day the military of this country who have given their lives in love for the sake of peace. We pray for the departed, their survivors, the living, those still serving and their families, with gratitude and for healing. We pray, Lord, that you would make us grateful for the peace they sought by making each of us more peaceful. So, Lord, as you taught us, we pray for our enemies, that all people would come to know kinship with all that you have made, and the unending love and joy of the Prince of Peace, our Savior Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, now and forever. Amen. On page 360, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please rise. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Peace. Please be seated for just a moment. Good morning again. It's good to see you all, good to be with you all today. I don't know about y'all, but I've been especially grateful for the church throughout the week, having friends calling to check in and people to lean on, coming back from a clergy conference, able to make space together at the taproom talks to talk about the griefs we were carrying. What a gift to have one another to carry those hopes and griefs in the same space. I want to highlight just a few of the goings-on things happening in the life of our congregation this coming week. Monday, Coffee Chat is back to its usual time at 10 a.m. online. Wednesday, the Art of Gathering book discussion group continues. That's online, as is the 5:30 healing service, also on Wednesday. Thursday, a new thing. Zoe Holmes is bringing back her Spanish class that we did last summer. It was kind of occasioned, prompted by our church's sister relationship that Bishop Sumner gave us with Santa Natividad in Plano, and is wonderfully successful. So this summer came around and Zoe said, there are people asking me when we're going to start it again. And I was like, that's wonderful. So the thing about this class is all levels of ability are welcome, as evidenced by my participation in it. And so you can be someone who's just starting, you can be someone who has some conversational Spanish and you just are looking for an opportunity to practice a little bit. You can be someone who's completely fluent and just looking for an opportunity to grow in conversation. Zoe's a fantastic teacher, and it's a lunch hour kind of arrangement on Thursday in the parish hall, so everyone is welcome to that. Friday is the first of our backyard fire pit complaints. And at first I told Marilyn that must be a typo because those don't start until June. And she said, Jonathan, it's June. So flagging that in case you're in my boat, not checking the calendar enough. But the first one is at the Buchanan's. They're hosting. They're on this side of town. All of these are short services, social services. So we have a little bit of just getting to be with each other. And then a fire pit compline, which is the short end of day prayers from the prayer book. And so there's fire, s'mores, and fellowship. You are invited to all of them, any of them, none of them, but we want to kind of flag the neighborhood that are in, because one of the hopes is that you might go to one in your neighborhood and discover that someone maybe five pews behind you lives two blocks from you, that kind of thing. So it's the south side this time, and at the Buchanan's. That address has been sent out by email, and if you need it, don't have access to that, just shoot me a note, and we'll be glad to make sure you have that for this Friday at 7. I do want to let you know that the Vacation Bible School registration is online and open. If you'd like to sign up or talk to a child in your life, a grandchild, child, it's going to be wonderful. Jordan's doing a wonderful job organizing that. We have a Memorial Day exhibit set up by Nelson attending the 8:15 service on behalf of the Brotherhood of St. Andrews, and that's... you can check it out. Sort of, I've been telling people before after services, but y'all are like so close to the end of this one. Just after the service, I invite you to the parish hall. It's a really moving tribute to all that Memorial Day contains. Do we have any birthdays, anniversaries, or baptismal anniversaries to celebrate today? Oh, we got a bunch of people moving. So we're going to do, let's say birthdays over here. Baptisms over here, and anniversaries. Ordination. What? Ordination anniversary. Oh, go ahead. You're going over there. How many years for your ordination 23. Anniversary? 23. Praise God. We're going to have to make up a prayer for that one.
Well, let's just see if you could wing it. I'll bet you can.
And Deacon Bonnie, you were a part of this church back years ago.
Yes.
I don't know that everybody knows that, but...
A lot of people do. There are lots of wonderful, familiar faces. I'm getting much older.
It is wonderful to have you here and to be able to celebrate your anniversary with you.
I'm delighted.
All right, we're going to start over here with William and the baptismal anniversary. William, it is good to see you. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that by water and the Holy Spirit you have bestowed upon this, your servant William, the forgiveness of sin, have raised him to the new life of grace. Continue to sustain him, O Lord, we pray, in your Holy Spirit. Give him an inquiring and discerning heart, the courage to will and to persevere, a spirit to know and to love you, and the gift of joy and wonder in all your works. Amen. Thank you for living the light of Christ for all of us, William. We are blessed by you. Anniversary. Marlo and Bob, how many years for y'all? 11. Happy birthday. Happy anniversary. Happy anniversary. It's been an emotional weekend. Happy anniversary. Let us pray. O God, you have so consecrated the covenant of marriage that in it is represented the spiritual unity between Christ and his church. Send, therefore, your continued blessing upon these your servants, that they may so love, honor, and cherish each other in faithfulness and patience and wisdom and true godliness, that their home may be a haven of blessing and peace. This we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Deacon Bonnie, let us pray. Good and gracious God, you pour out on your servants your Spirit, sending us, calling us, leading us to lives we would not have lived without your calling. We pray with thanksgiving for your servant, Bonnie, for the vocational life to which you have called her as a deacon in your church. We thank you for making your love and life known to her and through her, through years in ways that have led to your glory and the building up of your church. We pray that she may always know your joy in her and that you would continue to use her as a vessel of joy and love in the world you love so dearly. We love you and we pray this in Christ's name.
Amen.
Amen. Happy anniversary. And birthdays. When are y'all's birthdays? The fourth?
Yeah.
Second? Very good. And we'll be praying our prayer on page 830 for anyone who'd like to share. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Watch over your children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts, may thy peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of their life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Happy birthdays. Finally, don't forget, next week is the great feast of Pentecost. You are invited to wear red and also to wear birthday hats. It's the birthday of the church. And we will be celebrating across the weekend. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Our prayers continue on page 367. The Lord be with you.
And also with
you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed death. And by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
on page 365, let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. Rejoice in the Lord. Again, let us say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen.
Rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God.